We had on ABC, LA beat up Brooklyn in BK by 25. Yes, without LeBron or Anthony Davis. Meanwhile, the Nets had Kyrie Irving and Kevin Durant was back, but no James Harden. Max, I realize KD was on a minutes restriction. I realize Kyrie was ejected, but still, we didn't expect this. What concerns you most about Brooklyn?
Well, let's put injury and health aside for a second, because you could say that about every team, right? We talk about that with the Lakers, with the Nets. What concerns me the most is this. Remember last week, Stephen A., when we were debating who the most important player on the Brooklyn team is, on the Nets is? And I'm not going to say, like, KD is the best player on the team. I'm not arguing that. Kyrie is the most spectacular. Harden's the most important. Look, I know, as Molly said, KD's on a minutes restriction. He was very efficient. Kyrie gets tossed, was beginning of the third quarter. I get it. The fact of the matter is this team, because they were losing when Kyrie got tossed. Like, they were down in the game. James Harden showed up to a team he hadn't played on earlier this season, fat and out of shape, looking like a hot mess, and was a walking triple-double with 30 points in wins. Like, Harden organizes that offense and makes that team basically unbeatable when he's on the floor. They were almost unbeatable without KD. You take Harden off that team, it is simply not the same. There's no one more important on that team than Harden. Now, why does that concern me the most? Kyrie is a proven playoff performer. I've seen Kyrie perform at MVP levels in the finals. We've also seen that from KD. And while Harden might be able to do that, and while he's trending in the right direction, his play is getting better when it matters most. What we've seen consistently in his career is when it matters most, he's no longer James Harden. That's the problem for the Nets, other than health, of course. If Harden somehow can't rise to the occasion in the playoffs, that could be an issue for the Nets. Otherwise, if this team is healthy, nothing can stop them. Harden, what last night told me, Harden, or this weekend, is the most important player on Brooklyn.
Harden is a league-leading MVP candidate. He's been spectacular this year. We all know, I know that KD is the most important player, not just the best player on the team, because the bottom line is this. They can win the title with KD and Kyrie. They can win the title with James Harden and KD. They cannot win the title without KD, but with Harden and Kyrie. It's just that simple to me. That's number one. Number two, what is my biggest concern with the Brooklyn Nets? It is Kyrie Irving. Because in the aftermath of this loss, we've learned he's not going to play again tonight because he has personal reasons to do so. Look, here's the reality. I'm not trying to... Whatever's going on in Kyrie Irving's personal life, it's his business. He missed a couple, three games or so earlier this year because of a family matter. Obviously, he was gone for two weeks. He said he needed a break and, you know, violated COVID-19 safety protocols or whatever, and ended up missing, additional seven games. And then after that, got fined for the two games. The reality is, when are we going to start talking about that? When are we going to start talking about that? I mean, from a temperamental perspective, the dude doesn't appear to be that reliable. We know he's spectacular. We know he's a superstar talent. I think he's the best show in the NBA. He is absolute, positively box office. But this is not a guy that seems to have a consistent commitment to wanting to play. Now, I don't know that to be true. All I know is what we're seeing. Once again, this is going to be 15 years. Already missed 15 games this year. It's about to be 16 tonight. What the hell is going on? You only played 20 games last year in Brooklyn. Okay, you didn't play in the bubble. Then you come out of the, you know, you didn't want people to play in the bubble because you wanted folks to focus on other issues. And it turns out you got your own issues, whatever they may be. And so we wish him and his family and everybody, nobody's wishing anything negative about them. Nobody's doing that. We all hope that everything and everybody is okay. But I don't recall Kyrie at any point saying, here's your money back. You know, you don't have to pay me, but you missing games at your discretion. I mean, how many personal days do you need? You don't play every day. You got 72 games this year instead of 82. You only played 20 of the 72 last year. What the hell is going on? Where you just missing games? Because let me tell you something, continuity and chemistry do matter. Yes, you can give them the ball and they can do what they want to do as individuals when you're going up against most teams in the NBA. But what about the elite teams? What about the Lakers, who didn't have LeBron and AD, and watch Ben McLemore come off the bench straight off the street and drop 17 on you Saturday night? Andre Drummond dropping 20 and 11. I mean, the Lakers ain't going away. Denver's not going away. The Clippers are not going away. Milwaukee and Philadelphia is not going away. At some point, the level of continuity and chemistry has to come into play. And when you're just missing games and literally saying, well, you know what? I just need personal days. I mean, damn. See, this is where the rookie coach that is Steve Nash comes into play. Because if that were one of the more experienced coaches, you think you're getting away with that? You think you're getting away with that? You're just going to take games off on three separate occasions in the same season. This ain't Dennis Rodman years ago, as was revealed in The Last Dance, Max, where he needed a break. So Phil calls Jordan into the office, and Jordan's like, if anybody need a break, I need a break. What the hell he need a break for? But they let him take it. And then Jordan had to go to the room and tell Carmen Electra, move out the way. Dennis Rodman, let's go. This ain't that. There's three separate occasions in the same season, a little bit more than 50 games in, where this brother has taken time off. Ain't getting money back, though. Ain't getting money back, though. But he's taking time off. When is somebody going to say something about that? That's all I'm saying.
You knew where I was going with the Dennis Rodman thing for sure, because Dennis Rodman had certain issues. But he was a very valuable player when he was on the court, and Michael Jordan knew it, and Michael Jordan needed him, right? So Dennis Rodman can get away with it.
Nobody's saying to throw Kyrie off.
There are players like that in every sport, Stephen A. I think about our Yankees back in the day. David Wells would go and party all night, show up the next day, still, you know, wasted basically, and pitch a perfect game. Like, some guys got it like that, and you put up with certain things.
Max.
He showed up. I get it. I'm just pointing
That's
out.
That's what we're saying.
That when you are especially talented, the rules don't always apply to you the same way they apply to a role player. Let me say this. On principle, I agree with you in the sense that your point is legit. On principle, it's legit. Kyrie, boy, you're taking a lot of time off, man. Like, what's going on? You know, and you said it right. Like, we hope everything's fine with your family. But even if you're having family issues, at a certain point, while we can all acknowledge that's more important, we do have to assess you professionally. And if it's taking away from your professional work, then we comment on that. And people say, yeah, but you're not reliable professionally, even if your priorities in a larger sense are in order. As basketball fans, as observers, we could say, that ain't helping anything. But Stephen A., when you get past the principle and actually look at what effect will this have on the Nets, that's where we disagree. Had I not seen what I saw earlier this season, I'm with you 100%. Like, yep. You can't just, you know, walk off the street and throw it all together and beat the Lakers, let alone the Bucks and the Sixers and all these teams in the East and then whoever comes out of the West. But you know what I saw? Without KD even, this is why I go back to James Harden. Harden's basketball brilliance this year has been so far off the charts that they were basically the best team in basketball before Harden and KD even got to know each other on the court without KD. I thought that just don't, like when you say they couldn't win a title together, I'm not positive about that. But I'll tell you this much, when you add KD, with continuity or without continuity, if those three guys are healthy, good luck.
And like Clint Capella, who's no slouch defensively or whatever, I mean, to just get posterized like that, that was just nasty. Miles Bridges got hops. He's a showman. This dude, I mean, he will dunk it on anybody. His hops is off the chain, and you just fantasize about seeing him with LaMelo Ball on the court for years to come because of what they can do in the open court. That was clearly the dunk of the year. I know Anthony Edwards is in the mix. He's a candidate and a couple of others, but they, you know, hey, De'Aaron Fox over the weekend and what he did, one of his dunks over Rudy Gobert. I get all of that, but this is the dunk of the year without question.
Nope. It's Anthony Edwards, Stephen A. I understand that he put Clint Capella on a poster, and that means something. But forget about all that. I'm talking about from this season what I'm going to remember. Like, I know I'm going to remember Anthony Edwards' dunk. That's one of the best in-game dunks I've ever seen. By the way, I mean, he goes baseline. No, it ain't on Clint Capella, but look where his head is. Look where his head is. A dude that, how many times in the history of the game has a dude gotten his head that high on a defender in an NBA game? That's ridiculous. And by the way, because it's Anthony Edwards, because this dude was the number one overall pick and really wasn't playing well until that dunk. And since that dunk, he's been playing at a very high level. Like, it was like a turning point in the season. And I'm saying, like, I get it, Bridges, the way he, you know, the fact that it was on Capella, it looked great and everything. But we're going to see other dunks like that. I think that dunk is going to get lost in a bunch of dunks. This dunk is the one I'm going to remember out of the season. By the way, Paul George had a great dunk on a tired Pistons team that was playing the second of back-to-back on the road. But he had a great dunk. There are lots of great dunks throughout the course of this season. That's the best one, Anthony Edwards.
Oh, figures. Figures for you to sit up there and say, like, you know what, well, we'll remember Anthony Edwards dunk, but we wouldn't remember Miles Bridges dunk. That just shows that your basketball acumen is somewhat limited at times. Something's wrong with you, Max Kellerman. Something's wrong with you. For you to sit up there and say that we're going to remember Anthony Edwards, but not Miles Bridges, we're just going to forget about that dunk on Clint Capella like that. Okay, that's your opinion. I have to respect it, even though I really don't. But the bottom line is that there's no way on earth that that particular dunk is going to be forgotten. When we talk about the 2020-21 season, I assure you that that dunk will be just as remembered, if not more so, than Anthony Edwards. You can sit up there and debate it one or two, but let me assure you, nobody's forgetting that dunk from Miles Bridges for years to come. I promise you that.
They may remember it. I'm not for sure I'm going to forget.
It was on Clint Capella. And by the way, what about the landing? What about the landing? Because, you know, Anthony Edwards did fall because the guy was under him, and he did fall on the ground. Yeah, Miles Bridges didn't fall. He was standing. Yeah.
Bridges had more violence in the dunk. It's a great dunk. I'm not saying we're going to forget it. I'm saying, I don't know. Like, there are lots of great dunks. Anthony Edwards. But when I watched Bridges, I didn't think that's one of the best dunks I've ever seen. When I watched Edwards, and I think a lot of people were thinking this, immediately you're like, where does that place in among the greatest in-game dunks I've ever seen? There was something transcendent.